Good evening, King's House, and welcome to our online Bible study. It's going to be a great night, and I want to just say be expectant and trust God that He will touch your heart tonight. I know my husband has something on his heart to share with all of us, and we're just going to have a song of worship just to prepare our hearts and trust that God will truly bless us even this evening as we gather together digitally. So, Father, just bless us, bless your word into our heart today, and cause our time with you to be very, very profitable in Jesus' name. So, let's worship together.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed thy hands hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto
Father, thank you for your kindness, thank you for your love, thank you for your faithfulness towards us. We worship and adore you in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said amen. All right, thanks for joining us in that time of worship. So what I want us to do now is just to pray. You know, I know that a lot of us are going through a very, very challenging time. And our nation is going through a very challenging time. And the scripture in 1 Timothy, I want to read it to us. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 says, therefore I exhort that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. Then he goes on to say, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life, in all godliness and reverence. So right now, I just want us to uphold our nation, not just our nation, even all the nations of the world, because this situation is affecting not just Great Britain, but everyone. So can you just join me if you're with somebody, just hold their hands as we all pray together for our nation particularly, but for every nation of this world. So Father, we just lift up our nation into your able hands. And we pray, Lord God, that you give our leaders wisdom. You will give those, Father, Lord God, that are making decisions of what to do and what not to do. Those in the House of Parliament, Father, all our health ministers, Lord God. Father, everyone in positions of authority that is making decisions about our life at this time, give them your wisdom, give them your grace, and give them your strength in the name of Jesus. We say that, Lord God, you will give them peace. They will make the right decisions that will affect our lives in the name of Jesus. And not only this nation, we pray for all the other nations that are struggling to cope with this situation, Lord God, with the coronavirus. We pray, Father, Lord God, that we will recover from this. Every single nation will recover from this. And Father, that each one will be able to make decisions that is right. Each leadership, each government will be able to make decisions that is right. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. I want us to go on to pray for our church. Because God is our refuge and strength, Psalm 46 says. A very present help in time of trouble. Are you troubled now? Are you worried about your job? Are you worried about your children? What is it that is on your heart that you just want to leave at the throne of grace this evening? Well, I want us to pray about it. You know what's on your heart, so you talk to God about it as we all join together in prayer. The Bible says we should be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, we shall make our requests known to God. So make your requests known to God right now. Make your requests known to God. Father, you hear your people. You know their requests. You know their heart. You know where they're hurting. You know where they need answers. You know where they need you the most. So Father, we pray for our church family. Everyone, no matter where they are, some are even abroad. We pray, Lord God, for your peace in the name of Jesus. We pray, Father, for those that are sick at this moment. We pray for your healing in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray for the children. We pray, Father, for our youth. We pray, Lord, for our young adults. We pray for the mothers. Father, we pray for the fathers, the couples, everyone, the single parents among us, the singles, Lord God, among us, Lord. Everyone, the senior citizens among us. We pray, Father, that this time of trouble, you will be their help. You will be their refuge. You will be their strength. You will be their comfort, Lord. That everyone will come out on the other side of this stronger than ever before, in Jesus' name. And I want us to pray for our protection right now. I know that you all know Psalm 91. It's very real for us that God can cover and protect us even from this virus. So I want you to pray, and you can hold hands with whoever is with you. Lord, you said that when we abide under your shadow, you will give us protection. We are coming to you, Lord, for your protection, Lord, that you cover us, Father. We cover every member of the King's house. We put ourselves under the blood in the name of Jesus. We say that we're covered, Lord God. We pray for people's finances at this time as well, because I know that people are worried about income. Father, we pray that you will provide for them. You said in your word that you provide all of our needs according to your riches and glory. So, Father, we tap into that provision. We look to you. We trust in you, Lord God. And we are confident that you will bring this to pass in Jesus' name. And I want you to pray even for your family that is there with you right now. And if you don't have a family, I want you to just pray generally for the families in the King's house, particularly those with young children. Lord, we uphold every family. We pray for the peace of our children during these times. Father, the peace of our children in university, those that are not going to sit exams and are worried about their grades. We pray that you give them peace at this time. Those that are at home, Father, Lord God, just not even knowing what to do with themselves. We pray that you will guide them so that this time will be a constructive time for families that families will be able to make it through this time. And Father, we know that being in the house, everybody all day could even cause all sorts of things to begin to happen and even misunderstandings to come. But Lord, we pray that families will stay strong together during this season. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Father, thank you. Thank you because you've heard us. Thank you for wisdom and strength that is ours during this season and for the weeks ahead. You said if anybody needs wisdom, they should ask you. Finally, and you know, just please bear with me and hold on. I want you to pray for us. I want you to pray for your leaders. Pray for my husband and I, the pastors, the elders, all those that are leading teams and leading the life groups, that people that have to come up high even during this season, people that will be helping to connect us on social media and all of that. I want you to pray for them right now. Let's begin to pray. Pray for us. Pray for wisdom. Pray for strength. Pray for a clear vision for the weeks ahead. Pray that we'll be effective in guiding the church and in connecting the church together. Pray for us that God will give us all the grace that we need. He's already promised this, but that we will experience it to higher measure during these seasons. Father, we receive the prayers of the saints right now as your leaders, and we thank you because we know that we are strong, we know that we are wise, and we know that we've got what it takes to help to move your people through this season and to connect the church together at such a time as this. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. And everybody said, amen and amen and amen. You know, God is a prayer answering God. And prayer works. So do you believe the prayers we prayed today? I know you do. So what we're going to do now, my husband has something to share. And I'm just so excited because I know this word will really bless you. And at the end, I'll come back again to just close us up. All right? So just sit down, get your Bibles out, and let's study the Word of God together.
Well, hello, family. Thanks for joining us on our first online Bible study. These, as you know, are unprecedented times, but the Word of God has to keep on going out. And that's why we are coming to you today through this media. Now, today I want to talk to you about how to defend yourself against terror, how to defend yourself against anxiety and worry, and the kind of things that are going on around us today. As I was preparing this message, I was thinking of some of the Bible characters that we know of, people like Daniel, people like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, people like Job, who all went through tough times in their season and came out on the other side better off. They went in and they came out. They were not victimized. They didn't allow the things that they went through to tear them down or to pull them apart. They overcame those situations. And I really believe that each one of us can do the same. Even though we're going through a tough time as a nation, and many of us are going through tough times as individuals, I know that we can overcome the situations that we find ourselves in. So today I want to start by reading a scripture, and I'm going to start by reading the book of James chapter 1. James chapter 1, and we're going to read a couple of verses, verses 2 and verses 3. Now, this is what it says. It says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience." And then it says, "But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing." It says, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing. I like that word, knowing. You see, it's impossible for us to be joyful when things are not working out the way we expected them, except we know something. Now, I like the way the NLT puts this passage. It says, "Dear brothers and sisters, when trouble of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy." I like that. "Consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow." So it says, "Let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing." Now I want you to notice three things in this text that we've just read. The first thing I want you to notice there is that it tells us that trials and challenges are opportunities. Let me say that again. Trials and challenges are opportunities. Opportunities to do what? Well, opportunities to learn. You learn through trials. You learn through difficult times. It is an opportunity to grow. It's an opportunity to change. There's some things that can be changed because of trials coming your way. It's an opportunity to refuel. It's an opportunity to even rethink your life. So even though we're all going through this trial in this trying time, I want you to see it as an opportunity. That's what the scripture says. It's an opportunity. It says it there, consider it an opportunity. It says we should consider it an opportunity to be joyful. In other words, even though everything around you is not working out the way you would have liked it to work out, you and I have enough of God in us to remain joyful. You know, they can't take our joy away from us. It doesn't matter what the people do, what the government does, what the devil does. They cannot take our joy away from us. So this is an opportunity for you to be joyful. And you can only be joyful because you know some things. We're going to get to that in a minute. But the second thing I want you to notice in this scripture, that is that it says that trials and challenges are designed to test your faith. Let me say that again. Trials and challenges are designed to test your faith, to test whether you really believe, to test whether you really trust in God. In other words, trials and challenges are not all bad. They are testing something. Because you see, faith that is not tested has no real value. You know, I can imagine you wanting to go and buy a car or something very expensive, and you go to the showroom and they show you this beautiful car, and they say, well, you can buy this car and this is how much it costs, but it has never been tested. It has never been ridden. It has never been started. It just came out of the factory. We're not sure whether it works or not, but here you are, take it and buy and use it. Now, you're not going to buy that car. You're not going to buy that thing. You know, you want it tested, and you want to make sure that it would work for you the way it's designed to work. So trials and challenges actually test our faith, because faith that is not tested has no real value. The other thing I want you to know is this: your ability to endure cannot grow if it is not tested, if it is not tested by circumstances. You know, it's when circumstances and situations around us test us and try us, and we overcome those things, that we know that we're growing. So trials and challenges are designed to test your faith. The third thing I want you to notice about this scripture is you cannot be fully developed if you don't want to go through challenges. If you don't want to pass through challenges, if you're not willing to be tested, then you cannot really grow. You cannot be spiritually mature. If you're allergic to trials, if you don't like the hard knocks of life, if you don't understand that setbacks are part of life, then you will find it difficult to grow spiritually. You will find it difficult to grow emotionally, even physically. You have to go through some challenges. My granddaughter just learned to walk. And here's what's going on. She's having to get up. She's having to fall down. She's going through some challenges. Sometimes she stands up, and sometimes she's afraid and she falls back down. But if she never goes through that, then she will never know how to walk. So we're going to have to be willing for challenges to come our way. So James is instructing us in this, to learn to see challenges as divine opportunities. What are challenges again? Challenges are divine opportunities. That means we should be asking God to reveal the opportunities in what we're going through today. As an individual, as a church, we should be asking God, what are the opportunities that the situation we're in, the lockdown that we're in, can afford us today? I know that for some of us, maybe the reason why this is happening is so that you can have more time with your family. That's an opportunity. Maybe some of us are thinking of maybe doing some projects that we couldn't do because we just didn't have time. We were very, very busy. But now God has given you an opportunity. You have all the time you need to get that thing done. I mean, I want to write a book. I've been writing a couple of books for the last almost a year now, and I haven't got it done. Well, this is going to be an opportunity for me to sit down and get it done. So never begrudge challenges and trials, because at the end of the day, they can be opportunities if we see them through the eyes of God. So the two things I want to really focus on today, that I want us to do as a church, that I want you to do as an individual in your home, is I want you, number one, to build your faith. Amen. I want you to build your faith. Why? Because the just shall live by faith. You know, we have to build the ability to trust in God. That's what faith is. It's your ability. It's your willingness to trust God, even when everything around you doesn't look like it's working the way you would want it to. It's the ability to trust. That's what your faith is. So we're going to start by building our faith. How? Well, we build our faith by staying in the Word of God. We build our faith by reading and studying the Word of God. We build our faith by hearing the Word of God. In fact, Romans chapter 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing the Word of God. You have to hear God's Word for your faith to be strong, for your faith to be built. So what we want to do as a church is we want to keep on hearing the Word of God in these difficult times. We want to keep on hearing what God is saying. It's no good to listen to the news for 4 or 5 hours and then only spend 3 or 4 minutes studying the Word of God. No, you're going to have to study the Word of God and listen to what God is saying, and use what God is saying to push back what the world is saying, what the enemy is saying. Now, we know that, you know, we have to do some things to keep ourselves healthy and to keep ourselves from contacting this particular virus that's going around. But what we have to also do is we have to fill ourselves with the Word of God. Because if we fill ourselves with the Word of God, the Word of God will lift us up. The Word of God will heal us from the inside out. The Word of God will cause us to be strong in our faith and not to worry and to be anxious. So we need to build our faith, and we do that by staying in the Word of God. We also do that by filling our mind with His Word, with His truth. Not filling our mind with what the media is saying, not filling our mind with what people are saying on social media. Now, this, you know, getting information is okay. There's nothing wrong with that. But you must not fill your mind with it. You must not allow it to go deep into your mind and into your heart that it brings fear out of you. You have to always say, that is what the world is saying, but this is what God says. That's what the world is saying, but this is what God is saying. And that's why in Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, God said this to the people. He said, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night. God wants us to keep on meditating on His word day and night. And He tells us why. He says that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. In other words, God wants us to so focus on His word that all we do is what His word says. If His word says, don't be afraid, then we don't be afraid. If His word says that we are healed, then we are healed. If His word says that we have what it takes to overcome the enemy, then we know that we have what it takes to overcome the enemy. You have to understand that there are two forces fighting for your mind, fighting for your heart. One of them is the word of God. The other one is the word of the world. If you like, you could say the word of the enemy, Satan. He is putting fear in people. God is putting faith in people. And what you come out with will depend on what you hear. If you hear God's word and keep on hearing God's word, it will produce faith. But if you keep on hearing what the world is saying, what the media is saying, what social media is saying, what your friends are saying, then if those things they are saying are not equal to the word of God, it will produce fear. That's what you don't want. So it says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you can observe and do according to all that is written in it. And then God makes this promise. He says, for then you will make your ways prosperous, and then you will have good success. So you got to remember this. Faith eradicates fear. Let me say that again. Faith eradicates fear. Faith connects us to the promises of God. Faith connects us to the promises of God. And faith protects you from the fiery darts of the wicked one. The enemy wants to constantly throw darts at you, darts of doubt, darts of unbelief. faith is what is the shield that protects you from all of that. Amen? So we need to keep on doing that. So we need to keep on building our faith with the Word of God. The second thing I want to say to you today is that as a church and as an individual, I want to challenge you to keep on speaking or declaring the Word of God into your circumstances. Let me say that again. You need to keep on speaking or declaring the Word of God into your circumstances, into your situation. Amen? You have to say what God says about your situation, not what anybody else says about your situation. See, the reason why we do that is because the Word of God is powerful. Actually, if you remember, God spoke words to create the universe. Words are the tools that God used to create this universe. Words are so powerful and so creative that what those words declare is often what we receive or what we get, especially if we are using God's words. Amen? So, words are powerful, words are creative. The Bible says that God's word is settled in heaven. That means it cannot be changed. Nobody here on earth can change what God has said. The Bible says the heaven and earth can pass away, but not one jot or one tittle of God's word will fail. So the word of God, if you like, is like helium. It's you know, if you have a balloon and you just blow ordinary air into the balloon and you leave the balloon for a while, it will drop to the ground because the air that you blow into that balloon is not strong enough to lift it. It weighs it down. And if you like, that's how the enemy is. His words weigh us down. His words keep us down, keep us fearful and anxious. But God's word is like helium to a balloon, because when God's word enters into you, it lifts you up. Amen? His word lifts you up. And so that's why it's important to keep on speaking that word. That's why it's important to keep on sowing that word into your heart, sowing that word into your mind, so that when you start to speak it, it comes from the inside of you. See, so that's what the word of God is like. The Bible, actually, Jesus said it this way. He said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. It's an offense, a spiritual offense, for a Christian to live on anything other than the Word of God. Amen? The Word of God should be our bread and butter. If we want to hear what other people are saying, if we want to watch television, if we want to go to social media, it's fine as long as we take it with a pinch of salt. What you have to live on is what God says. That's how we live and overcome. That's how people like Daniel overcame. That's how people like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego overcame when they had their own challenges. They learned to take in God's word and raise that word above everything else around them. Amen? And so the word of God is powerful. The word of God is powerful, and it's powerful enough to change the things we see in the natural. The word of God is powerful enough to change the things we see in the natural. Let me read Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. This is what it says. It says, the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing of soul and spirit and of joint and marrow, and it is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Listen to that, say it again. The word of God is living and powerful. One translation says, the word of God is alive and powerful. That's why we ask you to make sure the word of God takes uppermost place in your heart. Let me read another scripture, Isaiah 55, verse 11. I'm trying to show you how powerful the word of God is, and why you and I should take time during these few weeks or months of us being at home to go into the word, to take it, to take the meat of the word, to internalize it so that it can strengthen us and make us overcomers in the days to come. Isaiah 55, verse 11 says this, so shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please. Listen to that again. So shall my word be, this is God speaking now, that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return to me void. God's word does not return void. If you speak a word, your word can be voided. It can return void. But if God speaks a word, it never returns void. That's why if we speak God's word, then that word cannot fail. And that's why the word of God is so important in these days. It says, it will not return to me void. It shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. God's word will prosper. Amen. It will prosper in God's mouth, but it will also prosper in your mouth. I want to say this about words. God's words are like powerful servants that go and do what they're commanded to do. Amen. They go and do what they're commanded to do. For instance, in the beginning, when God said, let there be light, his words went forth and pulled light out of darkness. Amen. And caused this whole planet to be flooded with light. When God said, let there be, there was. Why? Because God's words are very powerful. And because God's words are very powerful, we should learn to speak them. In fact, this is how Jesus put it when he was trying to tell us how powerful words are. In Mark chapter 11, verse 23, this is what Jesus said. He said, for assuredly I say unto you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Jesus said that. If you believe that what you say will be done, then you would have what you say. You would have what you say. Now, can you imagine you saying what God says about you? You will certainly have what God says about you. Amen? So words are powerful. In fact, the book of Proverbs tells us more about words. It tells us that we are snared by the words of our mouth. The things we say snare us. The word snare there means a trap. It means words are like traps. They trap you. And if your words trap you, they trap you either for the good things you are saying, or they trap you in the negative sense. I want my words to trap me into what God says about me. Amen. I want God's words to trap me. I don't want the devil's words to trap me. I want God's words to trap me. So, in fact, one of the translations says, you trap yourself by the words you speak. You trap yourself. So we don't want to speak words that will trap us and make us sick, words that will cause us to be disappointed, words that will cause us to lose our health or lose our life. We want to speak words that will keep us healed and keep us whole and keep us joyful and keep us on God's side. So there's someone out there today, I want to challenge you to stop speaking words that are negative. Stop saying things like, I'm afraid. That's negative. Why are you afraid? You have God on the inside of you. You have the creator of the universe who is your daddy. You do not need to be afraid. So stop saying things like, I'm afraid. Stop saying things like, I'm worried or I'm going to go bust. Who told you that you're going to go bust? Who told you that with God as your father, things are going to go wrong for you? Stop saying those things because you are dragging them into your life. You are attracting them. You know, stop saying things like, life is not treating me well. Who said that? Yes, you may be in a season in life, but stop saying it is not treating me well, because you are saying that's my destiny and that's not your destiny. Stop saying things like, oh, I'm sick or nothing I do ever works. Those are all negative words that trap you in those areas, and you don't want that for your life. So what should you say? Well, you start to say what God says. You say things like this: God said he will never leave me and he will never forsake me. I believe that. So that's what you say. If you're feeling alone, or you're feeling that things are not, you know, people are not there to support you, you just remind yourself that God is with you, because he promised never to leave you and he promised never to forsake you. So you say, I believe God that he will never leave me and he will never forsake me. You say things like, my God will supply all my needs according to his riches in glory, because that's what he said in his word. His word would change the situation. Even if you didn't have all your needs met, but you start to proclaim God's word, you start to declare God's word, then God's word will change that circumstance or that situation for you. You say things like, by his stripes I am healed, because that's what his word says. That's what you say instead of saying, oh, I'm sick, I'm always sick. No, say, by his stripes I am healed today. I'm trusting for my healing. I'm receiving my healing. I'm embracing my healing because God said so. You say things like, the greater one dwells in me and he's greater than the one that dwells in the world. Amen. You say things like, my God is setting a table before me in the presence of my enemies. That's what you say, because that's what God said about you. Amen. So I want to just close today by just letting us go through one or two passages, or scriptures, and let's see how we apply that to our lives. So, for instance, let me take one scripture like that Jesus gave us in Luke chapter 10, verse 19. This is what Jesus said. He said, "Behold, I give you authority to trample over serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you." Jesus said that. So no matter what I'm going through, no matter what's going on around me, I can take this scripture, Luke chapter 10, verse 19, and I can say to myself, "Lord Jesus, thank you because you've given me authority to trample over serpents, to trample over scorpions." What does that mean? What are serpents and scorpions? Those are all evil things that try to destroy us, that try to kill us, that try to poison us. So Jesus here is using a metaphor for the challenges that we face in life, for the trials that come against us. And he's saying, "I've given you power over all of those things and over all the power of the enemy." How much is left out of all? Nothing. You have power over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. That's God's word, and that's what you need to proclaim. And if you proclaim that, then it becomes a shield that protects you from the enemy actually hurting you. Let me read another scripture. This is in Psalm 112. This psalm was written to teach us how the righteous is meant to respond to challenges and troublesome situations. So David wrote this. And I want you to notice what he said. Let's go to Psalm 112, verse 4. Verse 4 says this: "Unto the upright there arises light in the darkness." What is he saying? He's saying if you're a child of God, you will always find light where there's darkness. Amen? You can always trust God for light. So if you feel confused, then rather than say, "Oh, I'm confused," you say, "Oh, no, I'm upright, so light is coming. Light is coming in this dark season. I'm going to get light. I'm going to know what to do. I'm going to see I'm going to be illuminated by God and know how to handle the situation that is in front of me." Amen? He says that. That's what he says. So that's what you say. Verse 6 says, "Surely he will never be shaken." What does that mean? That means no matter what's going on around you, you'll be fixed. You'll be stable. You'll be established. You will be like the rock of Gibraltar. You can't move anywhere, because you are established on Christ. So again, if you're feeling jittery, if you're feeling shaky, you go to this passage of scripture and you say to yourself, "You said that the righteous shall never be shaken. I will not be shaken. This will not shake me. I will go through this. I'll come out on the other side and I'll be better for it." That's how you declare the word of God into your circumstances. Amen. Verse 7 says, "He will not be afraid of evil tidings." Hey, so when something is being said on the news and it's causing fear to come into your heart, you say to yourself, "I am a child of God. I will not be afraid of evil tidings." The Bible says his heart is steadfast, trusting in the Lord. So you say to yourself, "My heart is steadfast and I will trust in the Lord." He says here, his heart is established and he will not be afraid. So you say to yourself, "My heart is established and I will not be afraid." Now, some of you know this already, and I'm glad that many of you know this and you confess it all the time, but there are some people in our midst who don't know this yet. And so for their sakes, let's be patient and trust God that they will learn it. And even if you know this, it's not all the time that you remember to do it. So I think what I'm doing today is trying to remind us that in these tough situations that we find ourselves in, what we have to do is to speak the word of God. First of all, we have to build our faith. And how do we build our faith? We build our faith by hearing and hearing and hearing God's word. And once we begin to hear God's word and it goes into our ear, through our ear gates, it goes into our mind, and then it goes down into our hearts, then what we have to do to get results is to declare those words, to speak those words. And when we speak those words are going to be like servants that are going around and making things happen for us. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. And finally, one of the psalms that is probably one of the best known psalms that we should be speaking to ourselves this year is Psalm 91. Psalm 91 says, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." What is he saying there? He's saying if we spend time in prayer, if we spend time in God's presence, then he will cover us with his shadow. Shadow speaks of covering. Shadow speaks of protection. God says he will cover us if we spend time in prayer. So I want to challenge you to find time to pray. Don't just sit down there and watch television from morning to evening. Don't just sit down there and say, I have a holiday. This is a nice long holiday. I'll just sit down and have fun and watch all the movies on Netflix. No. Take some time to spend time in God's presence. Because he says here, he who dwells. When you dwell somewhere, you stay there all the time. You don't go and go somewhere else the next. You stay there. My house address is my house address. If you come here, if I'm not at work, I'm at home. So when the Bible says he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty, he said if you take time, if you're prayerful, if you spend time in prayer regularly, then you will abide under the shadow. And then I like what the psalmist says in verse 2. He says, I will say of the Lord. In other words, the psalmist understood that the way to get God's word working for you is to say it. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. In other words, he's saying, this is what I'm going to say. I'm not going to say, oh, the world is coming against me and I'm nobody. No, he's not going to say those kind of things. What he's going to say is, my God is my refuge and my fortress. In other words, the one that protects me. The word refuge is a shelter. It's a secure shelter where you keep people. It could also be a sanctuary or a place of protection, a place or a safe house, if you like. So the psalmist is saying, God is my safe house. If I'm in him, nobody can get to me. The mafia can't get to me if I am in Christ, if I am in God. Hallelujah. He says he's my refuge. He says, my God, in him I will trust. You know, the psalmist understood what I'm talking to you about. He understood that, not first of all, that he needs to get God's word in him, but he also understood that he needed to speak God's word out to get results. In verse 3, he says, surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. In other words, in these times where there's deadly diseases or plagues or calamities around us, he says, surely. Surely means it's this is sure. This is something that it is true. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler, the trap of the fowler. You know, that's a picture of someone who is catching birds with a trap. Those birds, those lovely birds, don't know anything about the trap. They just go there to have some food, and before they know it, they're caught in the trap. That's exactly how Satan tries to get us and put us in a trap. But the Bible says if we're in the secret place of the Most High God, he will deliver us, amen, from the snare of the fowler. He goes on to say, he shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. Those are the kind of things I want you to meditate on over the coming days. His truth shall be your shield and your buckler. A buckler is a different kind of shield, but he's saying God's truth will protect us like a shield and like a buckler. Hallelujah. Verse 5 says, you shall not be afraid of terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. Because verse 7 says, 1,000 may fall by your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Listen to that. This is the psalmist. He's an Old Testament saint, but he has this understanding that you need to say to yourself what you believe God for. And he said here, don't be afraid of the terror. Many people are afraid of the terror in our nation today, but not you. You don't need to be afraid. You need to know that God will take care of you. Hallelujah. The psalmist said, don't be afraid. And I want to challenge you not to be afraid. He says, because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling place. For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your feet against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample on their feet. Amen. I want you to believe that, because that's what God is saying to us today. Because he has set his love upon me, this is God speaking, therefore I will deliver him. God says, I'm going to deliver you. He says, I'll deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. That's what God promised to do to his children. He He shall call upon me and I will answer. Listen to that. He shall call upon me. So if you don't call, there's not going to be anything for God to answer. But if you call upon him in this season, he will answer you. If you're worried about your job situation, you're worried about your wages, you're worried about your children, I want you to just call upon God, and he said he will answer you. He says, I will deliver him from trouble, I will deliver him and honor him, and with long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. I think I've run out of time, but I want to say this again. We need to build our faith, and we do that by hearing God's word over and over again. Number two, we need to keep speaking or declaring the word of God into our circumstances. We need to keep saying what God says, and then what God says will change our situation. Let me say that again. What God says in his word, if we keep on saying what God says, then that will change our situation. I'm so glad that you spent this time listening to what we have to say, what we're teaching. I believe it blessed you, and I believe that there's something that God wants to do in your life to teach you to always speak his word and not speak what the world is speaking. So let's bow our heads and pray and ask the Lord to do that for us. Father, I want to thank you so much again today for your word. I pray that the reality of the power of your word will dawn on us. And that not only will it dawn on us, but it will produce faith in us. I also want to pray that we would act in faith, not in fear. That we will act trusting you. And that we will rise up and believe your word, knowing that your word is powerful, that your word is alive, that your word is active, and that your word changes circumstances. Thank you for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you real good. Hopefully we'll see you on Sunday.
Wow. Did you receive that? Did you receive that? That you should continue to build your faith. Amen. And not only that, but you should also continue to speak the word, declare the word of God to your situation. And that is what is going to take us through this season. So God bless you for joining us. I just have a few more things to share with you before we close. Just a few announcements. First of all, thank you to all of you who joined us last Sunday. And those of you that also sent feedback to tell us how you were blessed. Thank you so much. Some of you even sent the link to your friends and family. Thank you very, very much. We really did feel very encouraged last Sunday. So thanks to all of you. And thank you to all of you that also gave your offerings, you know, through the direct transfer to the bank. Some of you use the PayPal link. We want to say thank you for your generosity. You are a giving church. And we can see that even though you're not physically there, you're giving generously. We want to say God bless and increase you more and more and more. So it's going to be the same. It's time to give now. So use the same link that has been sent to you. And if you prefer to do it by going, just doing bank transfer, that's fine as well. Any which way you do it, I know that the Lord will reward and bless you. And if this has blessed you, sow a seed. Because you know, when we sow seeds, we reap a harvest. So let's continue to sow. So finally, Sunday is going to be great. So you have to join us again on Sunday at 11 o'clock. Join us for our online Sunday service. And we're going to gather together again and worship the Lord and praise the Lord and hear his word again next Sunday. So don't forget to join us. So let's close. Let's share the grace together, and then we'll do our confession as well. Is that okay? All right. Let's share the grace together. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen. I'm going to pull my husband into the shot as we just say, surely God's goodness will follow us.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen.
Okay, now our confession. All right, so we're going to do our confession. I hope you know it. And if you don't know it, just listen. All right, so I trust God for a remarkable year of fruitfulness.
I will endeavor to hear God's voice clearly, obey his instructions carefully, and serve his agenda willingly every day. As a result, everything God promised will come to me speedily this year.
In Jesus' name. And everyone said, Amen.
Amen.
See you on Sunday.
God bless you.